Back for a brand new series on BBC Two now. Lunchtime humour that's sure to clear the hangover. It's Lee and Herring.
Hello, I'm Noel Edmonds.
Blobby, 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 blobby.
And we're back at a new time for another 8 years of House Party.
Blobby, 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 blobby.
Enjoy it, you scum, blobby. Enjoy it, or I will have you killed.
Blobby, blobby, blobby. Blobby. More, come on.
Blobby. Wake up, get out of bed, put on your clothes, another day is dawning, turn on your TV. Time to watch This Morning with Richard and Judy. For better, not worse, it's live, not rehearsed, made for no money, not for anybody. Welcome your hosts, they're both Richards, do they have no idea, so let's see how they do on This Morning with Richard and Judy.
Last year.
Hello, I am Stewart Lee.
And my name is Luca. I live on the second floor. I live upstairs from you. Yes, I think you've seen me before.
Wait, is your name Luca?
Yes, it is.
No, listen to the question, listen to the words. Is your name Luca?
Oh, no, it's Richard Herring.
Do you live on the second floor?
No, I live on the first floor.
Do you live upstairs from me?
No, I live upstairs from Andy Cooper.
On your own?
No, I've got a plant. But it died.
Put it all together, all together.
My name's Richard Herring, I live on the first floor. I live upstairs from Andy Cooper, alone with a dead plant.
Good.
You always spoil everything I do. It was good before.
And coming up later on the show today at 12:23, we'll be taking a look at one of Channel 5's flagship new quality pieces of original programming, Changing Rooms, in which a hidden camera is placed in a women's changing room. And that's it.
At 12:25, we'll be talking to the producers of Robot Wars and asking them if it's strictly necessary for all the presenters of that show to talk like this. Give them a round of applause.
And at 12:45, we'll be taking a look at another one of Channel 5's new pieces of quality original programming, Changing Partners, in which people are forced to divorce their current partner and move in with the elderly woman next door, whether she likes it or not.
And finally at 12:52, we'll be explaining why coral reefs are in danger of being wiped out. It's because John Prescott is eating them all. And an amusing
the Clive Anderson
there.
Job there. And thanks, please welcome at the pianoforte, newly shorn like the lamb in springtime, Ted Danson lookalike, Richard Thomas. There he is.
Brilliant. Communicating only in the medium of sound.
Brilliant.
There.
And we're coming to you henceforth from the fashionable Riverside Studios here in West London, which is, of course, also home to Chris Evans' TFI Friday.
Oh, I love Chris Evans, Stu.
Oh, yeah.
I'm hoping I can be the new him, only more self-indulgent.
Possibly.
I was spying on Chris Evans the other day, Stu. He's a monster, a monster.
Rich, saying it in staccato fashion doesn't make it any more true.
He's a monster, my friend.
Rich, saying it in a Southern Baptist preacher accent doesn't make it any more true.
He's a monster,
Stu. What was he up to?
You know what he'd done? He'd frozen his bodily fluids onto sticks, right?
Yeah.
And he was driving around in an ice cream van selling them to small children.
Surely not. He wouldn't do
it's
that.
It's the truth.
Why?
I think what he enjoyed was watching their laughing, happy faces turn to confusion and, and fear.
And what was Will doing during this?
Will, he was sort of standing just behind Chris Evans, yeah. Watching, going... But, I still love Chris Evans, Stu. That's why I'm not going to call this show TMWRNJ anymore.
Don't. Oh, you didn't.
How soon they forget. No, I'm going to be like TFI Friday and call it TMWRN Judy.
Yeah, it doesn't work, though, does it? Because TFI Friday, that's like an outrageous title because the F, that stands for a rude word.
Does it? Which one? Well, it does in our title
as well.
What
does it stand for?
It does. TMWRN Judy actually stands for This Morning with Rectum, not Judy. What do you think of that?
Weak.
What do you think of that?
Weak.
How can one born of woman be pure? It's difficult. But if they are thoroughly scrubbed for long enough and hard enough, the stench will eventually fade.
What have you been up to this week, Stuart, I was wondering?
Well, this week I've been visiting all the people who gave me their address while I was backpacking around Europe 10 years ago to see if they really meant it when they said I could come and stay any time. See, your offer was just an empty gesture of politeness. You said any time. We'll set some parameters in future, you lying Portuguese fool. Oh. What about you?
Well, I've been hanging around in Piccadilly Circus in central London, stopping passers-by and saying, blimey, it's like Piccadilly Circus out here, isn't it? Then really laughing really loudly.
You've done that all day.
No, Stu, don't be an idiot. It gets boring after about 11 hours of doing that. Then I go down to Soho and stand outside the sex shop Janus.
Oh, yeah, on Old Compton Street.
Ah, I see you know it.
No.
And whenever an old man comes out of the sex shop with a bag of stuff he's just bought, I go, ha-ha, you like sex. And then I run away, Stu.
And now, the return of Greg Evigan.
Oh, good.
Hello, I'm Greg Evigan. I used to present When Insects Attack. A poor quality program based on a very slender conceit. I thought it was stupid, but it looked good on paper. Anyway, that's all behind me now. When Sir Isaac Newton invented gravity, he was oh so very pleased with himself. But would he have been so delighted if he had known the suffering that his gravity would cause? Journey with me now as we see what happens when things get knocked over, spill, or fall out of cupboards. Let's find out. This week, beetroot.
I remember it was a Saturday. It was an access day. I had Tim round for the night. Well, I let him stay up and watch Rory Bremner, and I sat there and ate my beetroot. I'd had a few beers, well, nothing to make a song and dance about. And, well, anyway, I've been getting this whole arm-shaking thing since the divorce. It made my arm shoot out and splash beetroot all over Tim's T-shirt. And, well, Margaret would love that, wouldn't she? Me bringing Tim home, covered with beetroot juice. Anyway, I started shouting at him.
Like a bull in a china
shop! I suppose
it
wasn't really his fault. The next day, we went to the market and found a T-shirt much the same. Margaret didn't even notice. Still, what if she did? I don't care. I mean, what's the world coming to if a man can't spill beetroot on his own son?
Peter Gibbs and his son, Tim Gibbs Norman, certainly won't be eating beetroot in front of the Rory Bremner show again, no matter how much they hunger for its crunchy purple tubers. Instead, they have feasted on the bitter fruit of experience that is served up raw when things get knocked over or spill or fall out of cupboards. I'm Greg Evigan. Goodbye. I made this.
Looking at the news here, I'm glad to see Prince Edward has confirmed what everybody in the media and the gay community knew for a fact all along. He has proved that he is gay.
You can't say that.
He is
true.
Prince Edward is gay. Everyone knows it. And he's gone and proved it by agreeing to marry Griff Rhys-Jones.
He's not married. He's married Sophie Rhys-Jones, Rich.
Hey?
A woman.
But how? He's gay.
All right, Rich, why... Why did everyone in the media and the gay community, why do they always think Prince Edward was gay anyway?
Simple, Stu, because he's 30, male, single, and he works in show business.
Well, so do you.
No, that's a different case.
Did his mum look like Bobby Robson as well?
You shut up, she doesn't look like Bobby Robson.
Now, if you've seen the news, Prince Charles has been complaining about the amount of money that's been going to...
Would you like a fruit salad, Stu?
I don't want a fruit salad, Rich, and I just leave it.
Do you remember fruit salad, Stu?
Yeah, I remember. I'll just leave it.
I remember.
And the Queen Mother's income, they're looking at cutting it to try...
Fondue, Stu.
What are you doing, giving me fruit salads and fondue?
I'm doing some ironic, nostalgic comedy about the 70s, Stu. It's the new thing, everyone. Remember fondue, Stu?
Yeah,
remember the 70s?
Yeah, I remember.
It was hilarious, wasn't it?
Yeah, I remember it, yeah.
It's like my favourite programme at the moment, Days Like These.
Days Like These, if you saw it, its main source of humour derives from the fact that many aspects of popular and consumer culture that appeared commonplace in the 70s now, in retrospect, seem absurdly naive or foolish.
Yeah, it's brilliant, isn't it? I'm glad you like it too. You know, Days Like These are so popular, they actually have to keep moving it around in the schedules.
Yeah.
to give the other programmes a chance. It's good. Do you remember the 70s?
Yeah, I remember
Do you remember
the 70s.
Those old Top of the Pops albums?
Yeah, I remember them. I remember.
Do you remember some old cars that aren't around very much anymore?
Yeah, I remember
Do you
remember them, Rich.
It's
remember.
Hilarious,
yeah,
isn't it?
Remember,
Do you remember the 70s, Rich? Do you remember them? Funny, weren't they?
Yeah, and in the past. And here's our aims for the next 7 days.
Aim one is to prove that laughter really is the best medicine by screening Robin Williams' new film, Patch Adams, 24 hours a day in all hospitals, and then watch the sick miraculously rise from their beds and leave.
Aim two is to remind Richard Branson that although the round-the-world balloon record has fallen, no one has yet sailed a balloon directly into the heart of the sun.
Aim three. It's up for the taking. Aim three is to make Lady Camilla Parker Bowles' public appearances more acceptable to unforgiving die-hard royalists by making her wear a Lady Diana mask.
And aim four is to hope that now Kelly Brook has been chosen as the new female presenter of The Big Breakfast, that it'll mean that all those B-list Channel 5 and children's TV presenters stick insect 20-something slags who spent all last autumn prosing in their bra and knickers in GQ and Esquire in the hope of being spotted by the Big Breakfast talent scouts will finally put their clothes back on and spare us the disgusting sight of their repellent, undernourished skeleton bodies and squashed-up Wonder Bra curdled milk chicken breasts.
Some kind of problem with that, Steve?
No, it's fine.
And aim five is to be the first to reveal the identity of Prince Edward's best man. It's John Inman.
Just leave that.
You see what I'm saying? Danny LaRue is going to be the matron of honour, Stu, Those to go. Look forward to them. Each week on TMWRN Judy, as everyone's calling it now, my friend, we elect an ordinary member of the public as king of the show.
And to assist us in that task, please welcome our two slaves, Trevor and Nathalie.
Trevor and Nathalie. Here they come.
Coming down the stairs.
Here they come.
Trevor and Nathalie.
They're wearing 70s clothes. Ah, ha, ha. Do you remember the 70s?
Yeah, I
remember flares. Look at it, it's funny. Do you remember the 70s, Trevor? Do you remember? Do you? No, Trevor, don't speak. We can't afford to pay you to speak, remember? Do you remember the 70s?
Trevor, of course, you'll recall from the first series our small-faced boy. And look now, look, he's grown a beard, look.
Is that real?
You know, Trevor, growing a beard doesn't make your face look any bigger, right? All it does is it increases the surface area of your head and actually makes your face look even smaller.
All right, leave him, Stu, leave him.
Anyway, you'll remember...
Remember the 70s,
You'll remember the king of the show will get anything they desire from this.
The hilarious 1970s things that are no longer available in the 1990s trolley. Ah-ha-ha! Look at it, Stu! Ah, look at it! Look at the stuff! Look at it, Trevor! Look, it's funny! Laugh at it! Ah-ha! Look! Do you remember Spangles,
Stu? Yeah,
I remember them, Do you remember 8-track car, Stu?
Yeah, I remember, Rich,
Do you remember, ah-ha, do you remember Ronco things, Stu? Do you remember Nimble Bread, Stu?
Yeah, yeah.
Do you remember Kaplunk,
Rich, they still make Kaplunk now.
No, they don't! It's from the 70s, Stu! Remember the 70s!
You know Days Like These has been cancelled now, don't you?
No.
Anyway, we'll be choosing this week's King of the Show after this.
My beautiful things. Curse you, God, for making me this way.
When I needed a neighbor, were you there? Were you there? No. You were on holiday in Portugal. How very convenient, Mr. and Mrs. Dixon.
For the show, we asked the audience to give in their reasons why they should be king of the show, and these three people here were the least bad.
Hello there, what's your name?
My name's Andrew.
Andrew, oh, look at his little face, Stu. It's almost as if he understands. And Andrew, you said you should be king of the show because I can fit my fist in my mouth. Well, let's see if that's just an idle boast or if it's true.
Which one?
Either. Quick as you like. It's more like his hand, but we'll let it pass. We'll give him a round of applause. And, what's your name?
Toby.
Toby, are you wearing makeup, Toby?
Just a bit.
Okay. Fair enough. Remember the 70s? You say you should be king of the show because he says my girlfriend's parents have never seen me, even though we've been going out since New Year's Eve. And we think this would be a good introduction. Yes, your future son-in-law is wearing makeup. And he got off with your daughter on New Year's Eve when she was drunk.
Okay, move over.
I'm sorry.
Right, what's your name?
I'm Nick.
Is that your final answer?
Yeah.
Okay, right. Nick, I should be king of the show because I got stopped by the police twice on the way here this morning as they thought I committed a burglary at about 4 a.m. this morning. He says I didn't do it. Well, we'll see. Now, the studio audience will democratically choose their monarch with the aid of this clapometer.
Remember the 70s?
So if you like person one, fist mouth man, applaud now.
To nearly 40 there. That's the highest we've had so far this series. 50.
If you like person two, the unknown boyfriend, applaud now.
Oh, that sounds better to me. But the machine tells no lies, that's only 40.
Or if you like the man who was nearly arrested, applaud now.
You're the king. Class of 90, there we go.
The winner is this man.
Can the king take the fools away? Oh! 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 Name.
Unreal.
Not that one. He is Nick Hancock. Yeah. And do you have a pronouncement as king of the show?
Well, I think basically the death penalty should be brought back and used on anyone of my choice, really.
Okay, blimey.
An unpleasant man. Well, the king, nevertheless, and he's spoken.
So, I say to you, it is easier for a camel or a very large piece of rope, depending on what translation of me speaking now you are using in the future, to pass through the eye of a or the needle, likewise, than it is for a rich man to enter the kingdom of heaven. Ah.
Ah.
Not saying ah, Matthew. What ails you?
I'm sore afraid, Lord.
Sore.
Don't laugh, Judas. Obvious what he meant.
We've been away from our jobs following you, and I have no money to buy food or clothes.
Consider the lily of the field.
Yes? Yeah.
See how they grow, and yet they neither toil nor spin. So I say to you, Matthew, do not be anxious about your life, what you shall eat, what you shall drink, nor about your body and what clothes you shall put on it.
Ah.
So what are you saying?
Ah.
No, stop saying ah. I don't understand what you're getting at.
Don't you understand? I do. I understood right away. It's easy.
Consider the lilies.
Well, I have done.
Well, consider it a bit more.
Yes, Matthew. Shut up!
I have considered it. I've considered it as much as I can. It's a lily.
Matthew, if the Lord God so clothes the lily, will he not much more clothe you, O man of little faith? Ah.
Look, stop going ah, all right? Stop helping you going ah, as if it's obvious what you're saying.
It is obvious.
No, it isn't. What you're saying is saying that we don't need to go to work. All we need to do is be like a lily, go out in the field, lie naked, and then God's just going to automatically give us food and clothes, is he?
Ah,
no.
Consider the lily.
No, ah. No, stop saying consider the lily, all right? It doesn't make any sense what you're saying. The reason a lily doesn't need to go out to work, stop saying ah, all right, and listen. It just gets food, nutrients, from the soil, from photosynthesis. But I can't do that, can I? I haven't got any roots, I haven't got any chlorophyll in me, have I? Not magic.
Ah.
No, not art. I'm a man
not a plant. We're not the same.
You are.
No, we're not.
Consider the lily.
No, screw the lily. Screw it up. It's not enough, is it? Just to go consider the lily.
Ah.
And then go ah. It's not enough. It's not an ah situation. I've got my wife on my back, right? Don't make a face like that, Jesus. Saying, you know, oh, I want some money for sandals for the kids. You know, no, well, I don't care. What am I going to say to you? Oh, it's all right. Don't worry, I'm just going to lie nude in a field. That'll sort it out. No.
Consider.
No. Answer the question.
Well, Peter understood what I meant, didn't you, Peter?
Yes, Lord.
Exactly, so...
It's pimpsy.
Yeah. So Peter can explain it to you, Matthew, now, perhaps. Well, I've got to go. I'll be back in a bit.
Well, you know, consider the lily. That's it. Ah.
And now it's time for an occasional feature where we investigate the work of the lowest profession on earth, lower than prostitutes, arms manufacturers, and the executive committee of the Man Boy Love Association. They are journalists.
Lazy journalist scum, lazy journalist scum. The hearts are dead and the brains are numb. Lazy lying journalist scum, lazy lying journalist scum.
This week we're looking at a very lazy piece of journalism, a formulaic joke that is made again and again by idle hacks. The formula, please, Ian Lee.
Here it is. X is like Y on Z, where X is a current personality or entertainer, Y is another usually old-fashioned entertainer, and Z is, of course, a type of drug. Here's some examples.
To give you an example, Michael Bracewell in The Guardian said, Reeves and Mortimer seem like Morecambe and Wise on acid.
Time Out called Phil K like Eddie Izzard on amphetamines.
And Lewis Jones in The Telegraph said, Trevor and Simon resemble Bill and Ben the Flowerpot Men on drugs.
How lazy. What drug did he mean? Or drugs have different effects, you know. Could mean hair growth or huge breasts if it's hormones. Who knows what he means?
Fantastic. And here's the traditional, arranged by Tim Cooper in the London Evening Standard. Lee Evans is like Norman Wisdom on acid.
But is that true or just lazy journalist lies? This week I decided to find out if Norman Wisdom on acid would actually resemble Lee Evans at all. And here's how.
Yep, that's fine. I've got the tea ready, so...
To find out what Norman Wisdom on acid would look like, I invited him along to our office for a cup of tea. And what Norman Wisdom does not know here is that the tea is spiked with the mind-bending hallucinogen lysergic acid diethylamide.
I've just got to go away for 5 minutes and then I'll be back then.
Please don't try this at home, ladies and gentlemen. Spiking the drinks of respected elderly comedians is not only illegal, it is also quite rude.
Half an hour later, the acid kicked in, and I was able to compare the act of Lee Evans with Norman Wisdom, literally, on acid. This is what Lee Evans is like. And this is our film of Norman Wisdom on acid. So this is Lee Evans, and this is Norman Wisdom on acid. So Lee Evans, sweaty, hyperactive, funny, and Norman Wisdom on acid, frightened, confused, old.
Mr. Greensdale!
So there's no similarity whatsoever there, and I've clearly proved that journalists are lazy, lying scum.
Yeah, I must say I'm looking forward to the reviews we're going to get for this show.
Oh, I don't care. Journalist fascist, Rich.
I admire you, Stu, for that. You're like Mark Thomas on Prozac.
Stop doing that. Now it's time for extra final scenes, where we make good films worse and bad films better by adding our own extra final scenes. Hence this.
Titanic, current plot. Against the background of the famous nautical disaster, upper-class English Rose, Kate Winslet, is romanced by Irish-American pauper Leonardo DiCaprio. Their daring relationship crosses all social boundaries.
Jack! 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 and though their love is ultimately doomed by circumstance. It goes on to live in her heart for all eternity.
Extra final scene. As Winslet is carried away by the rescue boat, the sprout-faced Leonardo DiCaprio, whom we had assumed drowned, bobs to the surface and says,
"Oh, thank God I've seen the last of that fat cow. Didn't know I've got on my Whitlow, but Jesus. So, at least I got to give her one. And I deliberately sank the ship just to get rid of her. That is evil. Thank you, darling."
Filmmaker Oliver Stone is actually currently being sued by the family of some people who were murdered by a couple allegedly influenced by natural-born killers. Now, I don't think you can start taking
I
that.
I think that's good, Stu, because do you remember that time I was accused of going into that changing room, the ladies' changing room, blindfolding myself and molesting all those women?
Yeah.
I can just say I was influenced by Rory McGrath and they think it's all over now. Get off.
Now it's time for this.
Oh, hi. You just caught me enjoying some milk. It's funny, ever since I drank the milk of unusual animals on the last series, I've been inundated with almost three letters from people who also like to drink milk other than cow or human milk. Most of you want to know, what's the best unusual milk to drink? Well, each week I'm going to be road tasting a few of the milks on the market and giving you my milk opinion about each milk. This week, bat milk. It's got a lovely fruity bouquet, though this is a fruit bat. And the taste? It's got a very woody taste in the American sense of the word. I enjoy the fact that the bat can deliver the milk to you wherever you are in the world at whatever height, thanks to its ability of flight and radar. On the downside, some rarer species of bats carry viruses that may one day wipe out mankind. For that reason, I can only give it 6 out of 10. There'll always be milk.
It's terrible, terrible. It's just like something Hale and Pace would do.
No, it's like Hale and Pace on milk,
no,
Stu.
No.
Do you remember the 70s, Stu?
Yeah,
do you,
said,
do you
yeah.
remember the 1st of January 1970?
Yes, remember, yeah.
Do you remember the 2nd of January 1970?
Yeah, remember, yeah.
Do you remember the 3rd of January 1970?
Yeah. That's not enough.
Do you remember the 4th of January 1970?
It's not enough.
Don't stop me now, Stu. I've got 3,648 more crackers where those came from. It's brilliant. It's a good idea.
My dad was a man. So I killed him! Kill all the men, kill all the men. Kill, 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 kill the men. Kill all the men, kill all the men. All the men were booing, and some of the women were too. I think the thing was that I was the only woman at that time that was actually standing up on stage and saying that all men should be killed.
And then I killed him!
I think without my Kill All the Men song, that the world today would be an unrecognisably different place. Amazing times. Today I review sex aids on live TV. At the back of my mind, I'm always thinking, oh, kill all the men. Incredible times for British comedy.
So, what have you been up to, Rich, while the series has been off the air?
Well, actually, I've just been over to Hollywood on my own. Yeah. I went over in the fall. That's what we call autumn over there. Yeah. To pitch some movie scripts. It's good.
Oh, how'd you get on, anyway?
Oh, it's terrible, Stu. They're hypocrites, are they? Hypocrites.
Saying it like that doesn't make it any more true.
They're hypocrites.
Saying it in a high voice doesn't make it any more true.
They're hypocrites, Stu.
Why?
No, they made the film King Kong,
didn't
they?
It's a good film.
A film about a giant monkey trying to force himself onto a woman, right? Yeah. They call that entertainment. Yeah. When I gave in my script about a man, played by me, trying to force himself onto a very small monkey... They said people would find it distasteful.
A script about what?
A film about me getting off with a monkey, Stu.
Where'd you get the idea for that from?
You know, from observing things in life. My life, mainly.
You are sick.
I'm not. I love all the monkeys. I love them crazily. And they love me back. That's why they stay with me, Stu. I'm not prejudiced, Stu. I like them all. Proboscis monkeys, spider monkeys, howler monkeys. Of course, they're all howler monkeys by the time I finish.
You are sick.
No, it's natural, Stu. Monkeys share 97% of our DNA.
Yeah, and they share 100% of yours, don't they?
They do now, Stu, yeah.
Now it's time for controversial columnist, our new guest, best known as the Ironic Review's voice of the gutter, Gary Putner.
You're having a laugh.
Good morning, lords and ladies. Me?
On BBC Two? You're having a laugh, ain't you?
Well, who's been having a laugh this week? Vinnie Jones, eh? Off to Hollywood? Ooh! You're having a laugh, ain't you? Evander Holyfield and Lennox Lewis? You're having a laugh. Don King's hair? Ooh! Has he seen a ghost? We're having a laugh. At your hair, Don. Labour MP Joe Ashton adjusting his tie in a massage parlour. Oh, you're having a laugh, Mr. Arthur. The Queen Mother, £643,000 a year, still can't afford a decent dentist. Oh, come on, Mum. One is having a laugh. We don't want to look at Nashes like Shane McGowan on the face of the nation's favourite granny. We've got Camilla Parker Bowles for that. Now, she is having a laugh. Days like these, whoa, you are most definitely not having a laugh. Not now, not then, or not never. Ta-ta, toffee nose, BBG2 toffs. Stick that in your arga and pan fry it. You're having a laugh, ain't you?
Gary Putner there, he's like Jeremy Clarkson on donuts.
Leave that now, let it go.
I'm here with King Nick. Enjoying being king?
Oh, it's marvellous.
Yeah? Did you enjoy Gary Putner there?
I did, actually, yeah.
Thank you. Good.
And now this.
Batten down the hatches! Oh, hello, children. It's me, Histor, Sky TV's crow, who is interested in the twin worlds of piracy and historical events. What are you doing, Pliny?
I'm batting down the hatches like you asked, Histor.
I said batten down the hatches. Oh. A nautical term.
Worm like a bird eats early.
For closing.
Egging.
The doors.
The core like a bird cores.
To the hole.
Hold like a bird holds a twig. Anyway, what's the news, Histor?
Well, you may have seen on the grown-up news that a sitcom about the 70s has been axed.
Axed? But what is the 70s, Histor? I have feather beheard of tit.
To find that out, we must fly back...
Like a bird's back.
To the 1970s.
The 19 eggs and the 7 eggs. The 26 eggs. I said eggs.
Shut up! Come with me now, Pliny. As the crow flies...
As the egg fries. What place is this, Histor?
This is the decade that taste forgot.
The deck egg that tastes of fried egg. And who is that man coming there, Histor?
Hello there, Histor. I'm a man from the 70s. Look at my clothes. They are slightly old-fashioned.
They used to wear clothes like that. Ah, look at you. Do you remember the 70s, don't you?
Would you like a cheese and pineapple on a stick?
Ah, you used to eat that, didn't you? You used to eat it. You remember?
you like to listen to my Bay City Rollers album on vinyl?
They used to have different musical tastes and audio reproductive technology, didn't you? Do you remember?
Would you like a blackjack chew?
Blackjack chews! They used to eat those, the idiots!
Well, this store, blackjack chews are still available in the 90s.
No, they aren't!
They are! And anyway, surely the fashions of any decade will appear ridiculous 20 years later. Besides which, the 70s also produced the punk rock revolution, the birth of grassroots environmental and feminist protest, and the most creative cinema since film was invented.
No, they didn't.
They did.
They did not. The 70s were ridiculous. Look at him. And there's an end on it.
There's a head on it.
So, that was the 70s.
The feathered knees like a bird's knees.
Look at what you have done, Penny. Look. You've killed nearly all my unborn children.
I thought you said back down the hatches, Histor.
I didn't, did I? If I wanted you to do that, I wouldn't have used a clumsy phrase like bat down the hatches. I'd have said smash the eggs with a cricket bat.
Smash the eggs with a cricket bat, Histor?
Yes.
Why, certainly.
Oh, no.
Destroy all my human children. And animal life.
Goodbye, children. Curse you, God, for making me this way.
Remember the 70s, Stu? Everything that happened
Stop
in the 70s...
Stop doing that now! Stop it!
Everything that happened was funny in the 70s, Stu. Do you remember the Baader-Meinhof gang atrocities in Germany,
what?
Stu?
That wasn't funny, Rich.
It is, Stu. It happened in the 70s.
What are you saying?
Remember the race riots in Soweto,
Stu?
Funny, remember the death of Pope John Paul I? Oh, I've gone Pope. Do you remember the assassination of the president of North Yemen? My North Yemenese head. Do you remember the murder of Sharon Tate by Charles Manson?
That happened in 1969.
Oh, you're right, that isn't funny.
No, it isn't, no. It doesn't matter, none of those things were funny, Rich, right? No, it's not enough just to remember things from the 70s. They have to be funny as
they
well.
They are funny, Stu, because they were all carried out by people with permed hair, tank tops and wearing flares, Stu. Imagine that.
I am truly sorry.
Anyway, we all know what happened in the past, but let's see if we can predict the future. Please welcome our next guest, all the way from the 16th century, Nostradamus. Hello there, Nostradamus. Nice to see you. And what are your predictions for events that are going to happen in the coming week, Nostradamus?
Well, Rich, prediction number one. This week, I think we'll see an Irish band beginning with the letter B go into the number one slot tonight. Prediction number two. Yeah. A cartoon will appear in a national newspaper of someone on drugs flying above the ground. Boy. Prediction number three. The Lord of Terror will come from the sky, and before and after, the earth shall be thick with frogs.
Well, would you mind coming back next week to see if your predictions came true, Nostradamus?
Fine, goodbye.
See you.
Nostradamus.
Hi, Nostradamus. They're quite a character, isn't he, Nostradamus? Yeah. Quite a character. He's like Mystic Meg on testosterone.
No, Rich, he's like Mystic Meg on a cheap pantomime horse.
Shh, don't spoil the magical illusion.
Okay, go on.
Now it's time to welcome back someone we all thought we'd seen the last of. My curious citric...
No, he's crushed to death, no.
No, that which was lost is found. Will you please welcome my only begotten son, the curious orange?
No. Yeah.
Mr. Rich, hello, Mr. Stew. I'm Curious Orange.
And what are you curious about this week, I wonder?
Well, I'm very curious to know. Why do I always sit next to the nutter on the bus? Every time you can guarantee
sit next to the nutter on the bus, do you? You do. A speaking citrus fruit haired thing.
Yes.
Look, I'm a bit curious about something myself. I'm curious, why are you here at all? Right, you were crushed to death by popular demand. Why are you here?
Well, Mr. Stew, thereby hangs a curious tale. I'm not sure I remember it all clearly, but I think it went a little bit like this. Like this.
Stew.
Like this.
Wobble, Stew.
Like
wobble.
This.
You're spoiling the magical illusion for little
people. Like this. I remember singing my song, and the children dancing, dancing. And then pain, terrible pain, people laughing, the taste of juice in my mouth. And then nothing. But luckily, not everyone wanted to see me dead. Professor rescued me, and using outlawed cloning knowledge, he brought me back to life. That mad scientist gave me the love that my father had never given me. Discovery. I knew Master was a monster, guilty of crimes against citrus fruits. I had no option. To resume my unique brand of curiosity and vitamin C rich goodness.
Oh, God, I'm delighted.
You know, son, I'm so sorry I just stood back and allowed you to be callously slaughtered last series. Well, I just laughed at you. I'm sorry.
Oh, that's all right, Dad. I forgive you.
Oh. Do not underestimate me. I will have my revenge. Now I am a genetically modified fruit Frankenstein. And one day, you shall all see my power!
What was that?
Nothing.
Ladies and gentlemen, he's like a tangerine on steroids. He's my boy and I love him. The Curious Orange, my friend.
Now, next week, the BBC are putting us on at the early time of 11.50 to avoid building up a following, and we're also... It's clock's changed, so it's about 10.50, so...
It's like
anyway,
days
that's the end
like
of the
these,
show.
Stu, that's what they did to days yeah, like no, these, because it was so
end.
Good, they moved
that's
it around.
That's the end of the show.
And no, Stu, we can't end the show, we can't. With that, we need a big 70s extravaganza, ironic,
no.
postmodern kitsch
no,
ending,
no,
Stu.
No,
we
no.
do, we need all the audience dressed up in 70s clothes.
Okay, if you
come
want to be king
on,
of the show next
stuff,
week,
everyone.
Write into
come
us
on.
Telling us
come
why, and the best three received will be judged by next week's audience.
We need some crazy 70s
food. Or if you want to write to us using 1970s postal mail, there's the address there for that. Alternatively, if you're a nerd from space, you can email us on that address there.
Pineapple on a stick,
no,
Stu.
Thanks,
come
Rich.
On,
or you can get to Rob Sedgebeer's website for us via a link on the BBC site, which is this address
dancers,
here.
We've got our 70s dancers, we need a 70s song.
I'll do that. I'll sing a song that is curiously apt.
Let's go. See you, everyone.
Well, you can tell by the way I use my whip and the woman's neck. No time to talk. Music
that's
loud. The women want. I've been kicked around since I was born. That's all right. It's okay.
That's
you may look the other way. You can try to understand. You need a chance to fight all night. Ah, 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 ah. Stand alive. Stand alive.
Port the Hype from the Oscars on BBC Choice this afternoon at 2, and then later...